Hello and welcome to my presentation. It's the final presentation for today. I want to thank everybody for joining us today at the IBC, watching all this cool stuff coming by. Also, hello to the internet. My name is Lars Scholten. I'm also known as Cyber, and I am a freelance CG artist based in Amsterdam, as well as a Maxon Lead instructor in the Netherlands. You may find me at the College of Multimedia in Amsterdam, where I do my trainings. And you can also find me on Vimeo, where I have a ton of free tutorials about Cinema 4D. So if you're interested, just join the club and watch some cool videos. I'm based in Amsterdam, as said. I'm a freelancer, and this is my studio. Well, my is a big word, because it's not really my studio. I could say that this little part here is mine. Yeah, I'm a freelancer, and we work as a collective with freelancers in the studio on multiple projects. And right here you can see one of my best friends, Olaf. He's the art director who works on many of the projects where I also contribute to. Then the guy at the desk, that's me. And Jabba the Hutt underneath, that would be Marius. He's one of our animators. But let me give you a better idea of our team. Well, top here, that will be me. I'm a modeler, rigger, texture artist, do a little bit of lighting, but you should not let me animate because I got a terrible sense of timing. Okay. This guy over here is Olaf. He's an art director, but he is a jack of all trades. He does so many cool stuff, and he has a very good sense of style. And at the bottom, you'll find Marius. He's a very good modeler as well as a incredible animator, especially when it comes to character animation. We got a fourth member in our studio, which is Tetje. And if you're a post package, you are in deep trouble, but as long as you're very nice, she's also very nice to you. She's also a very big part of the studio, and I'll just show you in a bit why. So we work on multiple projects, and because we all got our specialties, which is very nice, we can do projects in many, many different styles. And I'm sorry, this is an old project, already 3 years old, and already showed it on the IBC, to be honest. But it just shows we can do some photorealistic stuff. So this is for UPC. It doesn't even exist anymore in the Netherlands, but yeah. What you see here is an animation of some devices being destroyed by a piece of post package.
Naar 3 keer sneller internet met het alles in één powerpakket van UPC. Want iedereen die nu switcht naar 3 keer sneller internet krijgt dit voordeelvolle pakket met supersnel 120 MB internet, Horizon TV en bellen de eerste 3 maanden voor maar 39,95 per maand. Kijk op upc.nl/3keersneller. UPC, more power, more joy.
So the thing is, in our studio, we really like to try different kind of styles. We do not want to being locked up on only doing one single thing. And yeah, therefore, we just hire some other freelancers to join us if we need them. The next clip I want to show you is a project that we actually did for Disney Channel, or Disney XD in the Netherlands. And it's about Sinterklaas. Well, if you do not know Sinterklaas, Sinterklaas is the Dutch version of Santa Claus. And it's a tradition where an old guy on a horse, not with a sled of reindeers, but on a horse, arrives on a steamboat in the Netherlands. And it's a bit old-fashioned, I should say. It's a bit traditional, and therefore, in some parts, a bit lame. So Disney asked us, can you amp this up? So they gave us some colors, and they gave us some ideas, and then they said, knock yourself out. Well, that's something that's really fun, because they got some very cool neon colors in their designs. So what we did is just get the horse, rig it, and make him do incredible stuff after he eats some carrots. Oh, sorry about that. All Cinema 4D. Cinema 4D and After Effects, I should not lie. So this is something that we did with the three of us. I was the rigger of the horse, did a lot of the modeling of the town. Marius actually did most of the animation of the horse. He's a real good character animator as well. And you haven't seen the worst part that we are not allowed to show, because he was swimming in space, and we have done so much bad things to that poor, poor horse. But yeah, this is some stuff that we do. The video I'm going to talk about today in my presentation is a video we did for Liberty Global, and it's called Spark VR. And a little bit of a background here. Liberty Global has a lot of employees all over the world, and some of those people have brilliant ideas to improve the workflow of Liberty Global. So they decided to come up with a platform and an app, so people can actually, send this ID via the app to a group of other people who will look at it and maybe implant it into their workflow. So what they did is they asked us, can you make a video for a very long explanation script that is actually entertaining to watch and builds up to a certain point? So we decided with just the three of us, Liberty Global for the script, Kreukvrij, which is Olaf for the art direction and just about everything else, and me to create this animation. So it was a very small team. Martijn was the scriptwriter. He was from Liberty Global. The art direction was, again, done by Olaf. I did all the 3D rigging. And I should not forget, we also had a sound designer. And the good thing is, we did the project. We finished the animation. And one day, I'm looking at Facebook, and we see the scriptwriter over here holding a very nice award. He said, yeah, we won. And I was looking at Olaf, did we compete? I didn't know. Yeah. So, fact is, he actually submitted our animation to Promax, and we won gold in our category. And we didn't even know we were competing, which was kind of fun. We had a good laugh of this. Let me just show you the animation. We did a virtual reality version as well as a 2D version. This is the 2D version I want to show you, and it's a big Rube Goldberg machine.
So, you have an idea for the business? Great. But now what? Take it to Spark. Spark is our innovation platform, open for all employees. Spark invites you several times per year to share your ideas in campaigns. These campaigns focus on a topic or area that matters most to the company. Submitting an idea is easy. Go to libertyglobalspark.com, find a campaign you'd like to join, write up a brief summary of your idea and add any attachments that help explain your idea. Or use the Spark app, which allows you to innovate anytime, any place, anywhere, and add relevant photos to your idea. After you've submitted your idea, the fun really begins. Everybody invited to the campaign can now see it, share it, vote, and like. Let trends and inspirations add weight to your idea, and let your followers leave fruitful comments. Share your idea with others and watch it grow and develop. That's collective collaboration at its best. The ideas with the most potential are presented to experts from the management team to be evaluated. The most interesting and from then on so-called concepts will grow further with the involved departments. The best and business savvy of those concepts are implemented by the business. But the excitement doesn't end there. The best innovators are recognized and will receive prizes for their hard work. So what are you waiting for? Get your spark on.
So yeah, that's the project that we did. And for this project, we of course use different kinds of software. The first piece of software is, of course, otherwise I wouldn't be here, Cinema 4D. Cinema 4D is our mainstay 3D application that we use to create just about everything from scratch. A little piece of advice for people who are working with Cinema 4D and want to create normal maps, I would advise you to go to Crazy Bump. Crazy Bump is a free program which can convert regular photos into normal maps in a very clever way. And the good thing is, you can run it on PC and Mac, which is great. And it's also free. I think it's in beta for the last 6 years, so yeah. We did our rendering with Octane Render, which is a plugin for Cinema 4D and a GPU render. I must say, we didn't have release 19 at the time with the new Pro Render, but yeah. And of course, for our texturing, we used Adobe Photoshop as well for the storyboarding. And we also use Illustrator a lot for our textures. And this may sound a bit odd because you might have tried to use an Illustrator file directly as a texture file inside Cinema 4D, and especially if you're doing some net rendering, you get some terrible results. So what I tend to do is make my drawings inside Illustrator and just copy and paste it inside a Photoshop texture. This way, if a camera comes too close to the texture and it's lacking resolution, I can just scale it up without any problem. So a smart object is very nice, especially if you have little text, logos, and that kind of stuff. For the post-production, we used Adobe After Effects. And for the final edit of the 2D version of the animation, we used Premiere. So the project was consisting of a VR and a 2D version. And the thing is, we had 3.5 weeks to fix it with the two of us, Olaf and me. So this was including the post-production and rendering. This is also why it says, and some weekends. Okay, so you can imagine, if you're talking about an animation of more than 2 minutes, with all the contraptions, we had to create everything from scratch. That's not a lot of time. What I would like to do, therefore, is to show you, especially if you're interested as a freelancer or working in a very small studio, our production pipeline, or, like I would like to call it, Studio Production Pipeline for Freelancer Studios and Small Teams, aka Learn from My Mistakes, because I made a few. So let me just walk you through. Of course, you always start off with an ID or a script, unless you're making something directly inside Cinema 4D and just want to use it as a drawing tool, which is also, of course, perfectly fine. Then you go to the concept, a production storyboard, production, vis or visual storyboard, or they also will call it an animatic, and then dive into the post-production. And let me just walk you through all these phases. So for the script, we had one major advantage, and that is that the script was written by Martijn from Liberty Global, and we had some very good contact with the guy, so it was very easy to, well, get around. Liberty Global asked us to make the script visually engaging. It's a very long script. It's even sometimes a bit, I should not say boring, but it's long. And they also asked us, can you give it an innovative twist? Yes, we can. And just before, a week before, we actually finished a virtual reality movie for Disney. And we just knew the ropes, so we thought, let's try it and just put it in virtual reality. Why not? And then the best part, have fun. We had a client with not a lot of feedback. They just let us go. We got a lot of creative freedom, and they only said, well, can you change this logo a little bit, or can you do a twist over here? And they just noticed that we had so much fun, oh, let those guys go. They know what they're doing. So you could say, best client ever. But sometimes that's not really the case. This is another project I did. And what you see here, right here, is the script of this project, but I probably should say that you don't know Dutch. But yeah, this is the English version, and it starts off with, here I have a short description storyboard of the animation. And this is quite fun because no images were sent. This was it. This was the entire bit for the entire animation. So he starts off with, as far as I'm concerned, he's the bloody client. Of course you are concerned. I'm building stuff for you and you pay me to do this. So it even gets worse. This is the actual script of the creation of a data center with all kinds of server racks and stuff. And yeah, we started with 4 bare frames separated from each other, no reference at all. Built those on the floor frame, pillars and roof frame, UPS case on it, everything like that. But what I really like is this. Done. Yeah. Okay. Do you want me to write him even further? This is the moment that you're going to sit down with your client and make a new kind of storyboard, because this is wrong on so many levels. This is a recipe for disaster. You need something to grab on. So, gentlemen, start your 3D engines, or no, wait. First, if you're starting a project like this, go through your work environment. Proper planning prevents poor performance. I really like this poster because the topography really shows some proper planning here. So, a little inside joke. So, if you're talking about the work environment, you have to look at some problems you can encounter while doing this project. For this project, we used Octane Render. And as you probably know, Octane only works on NVIDIA cards. This was a major problem for us because my good friend Olaf has a very powerful PC, and I have an iMac 5K. which was a mistake from the past. And as you probably also know, Apple is all about design, really about design. And they have a tendency to have a little bit of design anorexia, make everything very slick, but if you have a graphics card this big, it doesn't really fit. So what we have to come up with was a system so we could work both on the same project. So what I did was, in Espresso, I made a script that could change all the materials that we created in Octane with those from Cinema 4D. So if a file came back from Olaf, I only had to switch one button, and I had all Cinema materials. If he was working on it, he switched it back, and he had all Octane materials. So a very handy system to work around. Also, some hardware check. The files at a certain point became so big that we really had to watch out that if I was working on it, Olaf still could open it, and vice versa. By the way, this is an Amiga, and this is Cinema 4D 2, I believe. some people don't know, but I believe Cinema 4D is about 25, 28 years old. Anyway, also, make sure that everybody's on par when it comes to the plugins and that kind of stuff. Another piece of advice, if you are working on a certain project like we did, I would really recommend you to use a kind of file sharing service. And I do not have any kind of stock in Dropbox, but it saved our asses so many times. It has two major advantages. Everybody is working with the same versions of the same files, but also you can have a backup from just an hour ago, which is really, really nice and, helped us a lot. We also use Google Docs a lot. And this sounds a little bit, boring, but what you see here is the original script, what we proposed for the script, and then the visualization that we liked to make. And the fun part is everybody's working on the same document, so there's no mistake ever. Everybody knows what's going on. So we use this also for instance, defining object buffers, masks that we create during the rendering of their animation. And to become really boring, I tend to name everything in Cinema 4D. And I know it's a tedious job, it's boring as hell, but after a month, you open the project, what the hell did I do? I don't know anymore. It's gone. Or in my expressions, I always like to have remarks. And what I really like to do is use layers. Layers are actually a bit of a strange name for labels. But what you can do is just turn everything off that you do not need, solo groups of objects out, and it's just a very handy way of keeping everything maintainable. Then, file structure. I hate the term final or def. I imagine people from Pixar sitting in the cinema, I could have done this better while watching the premiere of their movie. So we always like to save all our files incremental. And we go beyond with this. Look at this, file 375. So at this point, you can throw away the first 300, but it's always nice to be able to get back to a previous file. And another one, this is my blacklist of death. The reason for this, these are symbols you should not use inside your file names, especially when you're going to render on a render farm. Reason for this, the old DOS, H. Oh, look at this. I'm going to look for a texture, one file up or one folder up. I can't find it. Oh, let's stop the render. You do not want to get into the wrong terminology. And also like this final def, very final def, final def 2, final def 3, final def. Which file was the last file? I don't know. Yeah, thinking your stuff and, untitled, of course. Do not use these kind of file names. Be exact. So, that was the boring stuff. Let's get into some more fun stuff. Concepting. And here I also have some pieces of advice. First one, don't stay glued to your screen. I hear some people, I was sitting all night behind the computer and still can't do anything. My best ideas I get when I take a shower. Or, and this is why Tetje, our tackle, is so very important, walk the dog. Just go out of the studio, walk around. You are able to make faster decisions in your head if your hand is not glued to your mouse. Also, and this is something for Dutch people, which is very hard to do because we are cynical as hell, do not render a crazy idea immediately as wrong. If you're concepting, if you are doing a brainstorm, do not be, very harsh to each other. Ah, this is going to suck anyway, because you will throw in your own windows and yeah, leave the train of thought going. Then, first, the research, we started with the color palette. This is another of our Sinterklaas movies. We're very proud of that. And the story behind this is Sinterklaas arrives in a steamboat, which is slow. So we decided, well, again, to amp everything up. It looks pretty cool. But we started off with a color palette, and this color palette makes everything incoherent. It's one big thing. And we did exactly the same when we researched our color palette for the entire animation, just to make, again, everything very coherent. So we just went on a thing called the internet, Google, got some images, and we sticked up with just this palette. We do not have a lot of other colors out there, maybe for some logos, but these were the materials that we used through the entire animation. Then we also did a lot of research about materials, the look and feel we want to have inside the animation. We, for instance, really like this grid pattern. You will see it throughout the animation. And also these fine metal lines. We used them in aluminium because it suited our project more. And again, something like this, a hand holding a purse, we used it as the start of the animation. And of course, researching the materials, this is what you then end up with. A lot of wood, a lot of orange, a lot of green, and one coherent view. Then, and this is where I came in, the research of the contraptions, and this is so much fun. We had so much fun watching real Rube Goldberg machines, and the major challenge that we had, what you do not see in a 2D version, is that it had to work like a real Rube Goldberg machine. And this is where people who are interested in Cinema 4D, and not me talking about workflows, might get a little bit more interested, because working with dynamics, and it has to work in one go, because you have only one camera shot, is pretty hard to do. And also, the world had to be interesting in 360 degrees, because we are creating a virtual reality movie. So, we did some studies on the internet about virtual reality, and we noticed that some people find the virtual reality camera, just turn it on, and shoot a movie like they do originally, with their own layout. Problem is, in virtual reality, you do not have a layout. The layout is defined by the user. So if you have lots and lots of space with nothing going on, it's going to be boring as hell. So another thing that we skipped, we didn't want to have very high detailed environments because it takes a lot of time to create, and it would also take the focus of our viewer of the animation. We didn't want to have water simulation because it takes ages to do. Not really the rendering, but making sure that the water is going into the correct direction, and we do not have a real flow artist in our studio. So we also avoided smoke fire simulations or character animations because it didn't match the style. Then we did some research of the contraptions, and I just started doodling, really, inside Photoshop, started doodling all those contraptions, and from there, this is actually a Photoshop file of 1.5 meters long, PSB, with all the ideas I had and just putting around. Now we get to the fun stuff. So, for the production storyboard, this is what we came up with. A hand pushing some dominoes, then the dominoes would fall in a little ball, rolling out a banner, then a truck would be released. Well, you could just go through the entire storyboard. Everything was decided before we even started with the 3D animation. So you see, some of the ideas remained, some of the ideas were scrapped afterwards. We decided to have some kind of X-ray screen for the balloon, and later we decided it did not really fit the style of the animation, so we decided to replace them with magnifying glasses, stuff like that. But the basic part is always still in there. So finally, production. And yeah, first thing, of course, modeling. And when I start modeling, the first thing I like to know is what is the distance of the model to the camera, because the scene was so huge, we were not able to do everything in a very high detail. So we first decide how important is this model going to be. Is it going to be a hero object? Is it going to be an object in the distance? Also, reference. If you need to recreate something, theblueprint.com is a very good resource for a lot of reference material. And can we use parts from older projects? You have seen the horse grabbing some carrots from a shoe, the same shoe we used in this animation. It even has the same S on it from Sinterklaas or Spark. That was a coincidence, but still, it's pretty cool. And then something that some 3D artists now are getting very mad. Can we buy the 3D model?
Oh,
yeah. If a model is just about the same in detail for your scene, I think you're allowed to buy a model once in a while. We use some plans, for instance. Yeah, you can spend all your time modeling a certain object, but there's so much work to do. You know, if it's not really standing out of your animation, if it fits your style, I don't think it's a bad thing to buy a model. So you can go to TurboSquid CG Trader, or, if you're smart, Thingiverse, which is a marketplace for 3D models for 3D print. And you can find some interesting stuff over there as well. Then we just go to for some reference, recreate the objects inside Cinema 4D, just do some basic modeling, and adjust the model accordingly. Another nice resource, eBay. We actually found this van, and just for selling purposes, the owner, of the previous owner, I should say, took pictures from the side, the front, the top, so we had the perfect reference to recreate this fan. Then, my favorite part, of course, this is where I come in, animation and simulation. And I'll just show you this animation of the little plane, and yeah, sometimes stuff does not really work out. This plane was actually supposed to pick up those little wooden boards, but yeah, it was going a little bit too fast, so we had to adjust a lot. But also, something you really have to keep in mind is the structure inside your object manager. Currently, the plane is following the wheel instead of, you can see it over here, it's one frame late. So this really depends on your structure inside your object manager. The wheel is probably calculated later in this row than the airplane. So therefore, it's calculated a frame later, and therefore, it's running late. So things like that. So when we go into simulations, we tend to split everything up. We first test case first simple simple examples in simple environments. You cannot do everything at the same time. It's just impossible. We use proxies. We build the scene in separate files, and we bake the dynamics. And this is one of the most important parts. Let me just show you. First, the simple scenes. This is an idea we had first. And our idea was, well, all these dominoes will fall over, and just like Domino D-Day, you will see a logo reveal. It was freaking impossible. Those dominoes were going everywhere, so this text we wanted to show was just completely messed up. We were very lucky to test this in an early phase. So we just scrapped the scene, scrapped the idea, and went on with a different kind of idea. We're using proxies a lot. This is the model of the airplane we used in the animation. And this is the model that was actually responsible for picking up all those wooden plates. The mistakes you saw were because we were using this model instead. This is a model that just goes with the exact same position as its original brother, and it's constructed from really cubes. Very, very simple, simplistic cubes. So the dynamics calculation can be done very easily, and it's easy also to adjust. So it's a lighter version of the model. And we also like to use separate files. This device did not really make it to the final cut. We didn't really like the banner after all. So we skipped it and also was not working time-wise. So we scrapped it. But yeah, we just built everything up in separate files and reconnect them by using XREF objects. And I love XREFs. XREFs are objects that connect a Cinema 4D file to another Cinema 4D file. And right here you can see I got this model. Don't look at the modeling, I built it about 8 years ago or something. And I want to make some changes to the wheel. I'll just open the XREF file. It opens a separate file with only the wheel. I can make my modifications here. And right now I can just save the file. Yep. Go back to my original file. And reload it. And this gives us the opportunity to use a certain file in multiple master files, or in this case, make everything in segments. And then, probably the most important part. This is actually a screen from another project that we did for Disney. It's called Milo Murphy's Law. It's also a virtual reality game. You can play it on Disney XL on their YouTube channel. And there's so much stuff happening over here. This is, for instance, an egg protector, which just bounces around and just throws everything over and, well, smashes all kinds of stuff. Then we have a truck driver who does a terrible parking job and just knocks over all kinds of streetlights. And then we have a dog walking over here, which is almost killed by a train car coming up and just crashing through the ground. Just about now. Now? Now. Yeah. So you have to time this. And the only way you can do this, especially when you're working with Dynamics, is to bake everything. You must know that if you're using Dynamics inside Cinema 4D, one change on a certain model can completely change the result of another dynamic calculation as well. So if something works, you just want to pin it down. Okay, this works. Don't touch it anymore. So what we like to use is the Alembic format, which is not really an export format, but more like a database file connected to your Cinema 4D scene. The major advantage of Alembic is it's just a frame-by-frame cache of points and polygons, maybe some splines and particles. Nothing more than this. And therefore, you need to link it to your Cinema 4D file. You can just exchange the information, you can adjust the Alembic file, and Cinema 4D will update accordingly. And this will result in some, well, marvelous results. For instance, this is one of the contraptions that we made. And you'll see all those marbles just rolling in. This was a heavy file for Alembic. I think it was just about 1 gigabyte. But the Cinema 4D file was only just about 100 MB. But even better, you might also have noticed that the Rube Goldberg machine worked perfectly. Not one of those marbles was missing or flipping over the side. And that's because we deleted them afterwards. We just started off with just pulling this thing up, completely up with marbles. And at a certain point, they were just coming over the side of the box, gone, move. So this is a very handy trick. So the entire main scene was 71 MBs, and the Alembic files were just about a gig. But it can get even better. We did another animation for Liberty Global, it's called Zoom. And all these characters were actually created in Anima, which is a character animation program. Can't really recommend it, it's buggy as hell, but they have a version 2, maybe they improved. Anyway, we had all these people walking around in a scene, which was just about 7 MB. Seven. The cache of all the people walking was 30 gigabytes, but that's not really matters because, well, it's only linked. And Cinema 4D, frame by frame, just gets the information from this Alembic file, so you can create stuff like this. The only thing you see here is actually a very simple solution. These are cloners. Cloners with render instances on, of course, made out of just cloning people on polygons. We used the time effector from MoGraph to push these people in a direction, otherwise they will do a Michael Jackson on the same place. And used a target effector just to get them somewhere, or a rate effector to, well, get them over a spline. The cameras are moving so fast, so we didn't need to have any kind of collision detection going on. And yeah, if you're just moving like that, it's already very convincing. And this just took us about 2 weeks to recreate. The only problem that we had was, in some scenarios, because we're using Octane, the GPU was, well, a bit overwhelmed. And some of the people are just frozen in time, but you can't see them because there are hundreds of them. So this is something you can do with Alembic. 30 gigabytes of data, 7 MB file. Very, very powerful. And the only thing you have to do is just export it. Alembic, and you're done. So from there, we created a fizz. And right here, you can see the virtual camera or the virtual reality camera moving very slowly through our scene. Still, the dynamics are not perfect, as you can see here, because this little ball should roll through, and the arrow is already going, and there's nothing going on here, and these guys are moving and probably falling apart. But yeah, shortly but surely, we're recreating this entire scene. Something that might be interesting is the fact that the camera is not turning around. And I'll tell you why in just a bit. So from there, we did a beauty pass, sent it to our client. And another little piece of advice is in the render settings, you'll find something called FrameStep. And FrameStep makes it possible to, well, have some kind of pinpoints, or I should say samples, through your animation. So if you have a FrameStep from 10, you just render frame 1, or 0, sorry, 0, 10, 20, 30, 40, 50. And therefore, you don't have to render your entire animation to get a global overview of what's going on. I also like to use the same principle if I'm doing a big render for, let's say, a turntable model. I have a package from a client, and he looks at the turntable and says, oh, great, can you give me some high resolution files as well? Sure, I can render an A4 for you, no problem, Cinema 4D can do this. Which frame do you like? And he just scratches his head and says, what's a frame? Okay, let me just give you a sample rate of this animation. So this is a thing you can do. And then the rendering. Oh dear, virtual reality. And first thing you have to know, is virtual reality really worth looking at? And I did a presentation about virtual reality in the past in Hilversum, and a guy comes up to me and has a question. Are all movies in the future going to be virtual reality? Hell no. Absolutely not. Because with virtual reality, you just throw away all the tools a director has to focus the focus of a viewer where he should look inside your animation or inside his movie. You can't direct by light, you can't direct by camera angles. You just throw them all away. So, yeah. Is VR then the next 3D TV? This is actually my first Google search. 3D TV is dead. No, I don't think so. Virtual reality is a very, very good method of, well, giving some information to a person. Just watching a virtual reality movie can lead to very cool stuff. Little history, of course, virtual reality started off as a part of science fiction. Think Ghost in the Shell, The Matrix, Lawnmower Man. And yeah, we started off with some very crazy machines before we started off with the headsets that we have today. The Sensorama is one of my favorites from 1962. The ViewMaster, of course, you can now buy, by the way, a Google Cardboard version from this. I also really like this device. You need some very nice neck muscles to keep that one up. It's amazingly big. Apple in 1991 came with the Virtual Museum, which was a virtual experience. And Nintendo actually had the Virtual Boy, which has a stand. And this stand was not necessary to keep the device up, but then children would not be able to put it on their head and run outside. So it's a safety measure instead of a feature. Anyway, with the introduction of the iPhone, we had a certain system that could be used in the first Oculus Rift. And from there, we have some current devices that we now can use for virtual reality. But more important, I really like the cardboard, especially because it's so cheap. But nowadays, you can also watch it on YouTube and also watch it on Vimeo, which is, I think, a very cool thing. So where can VR be useful? I think it will lose its charm as a gimmick, as something fun, like we really introduced it to the client. Just about the end of 2017, then it's not very new anymore. But it's very cool for games and rides. It's a perfect method for registration of concerts and other kinds of events. You can use it, of course, for architecture, so you can walk around in your own house. Educational purposes, there are some virtual reality versions of, doing some surgery on a person, or maybe for engineering, working on a car that does not exist. And also experience. You can nowadays buy experience, virtual reality experience on the internet. So I want to spend a half an hour underwater, no problem. Just put on your set and chillax. If you want to capture virtual reality in real life, you probably need a special camera, like for instance this guy, or you have to do some stitching of your photos or your film. In 3D, you will need a very nice spherical cam. And before, we used a plugin called CVVRCam from Cineversity. Most render engines also have a spherical cam. For instance, V-Ray has one, Octane has one. There were also some nice plugins for Arnold. And then, after we finished the project, 2 months later, Cinema 4D also had one. So, just a bit too late, sorry about that, but it's a very good one, and it has lots of options. So if you now render a virtual reality scene from Cinema 4D, You can do a mono render, which is just about 360 degree environment, which is, I think, very nice. But also stereo. If you have a headset like a HTC Vive or maybe a Oculus Rift, you have two screens, every screen for one eye. And you have a left view and a right view, which are separated just about 6 centimeters from each other when it comes to the camera position. And this gives you a feeling of parallax and real 3D feel. They also have a cubic render, and this is very interesting for people who are creating skyboxes, for instance, Unity 3D or for Unreal. So, if you're talking about rendering in virtual reality, one thing that's very important, make sure that VR adds value to your project. Don't use it because you can. Oh, look, it's a camera. Let's press it. It's a bad thing. Make your scene 360 degrees of interesting. We actually designed the entire room of the animation around the camera, so even if you're not following the action, there's actually something interesting to look at. And also, make sure that objects move in your scene to create a feeling of parallax. You're actually panning around, and if objects are not moving, it feels very 2D-ish. So make sure you have a little bit of parallax in your world. Also, important to remember, you will need a lot of pixels, 4K territory. So watch out, it's a very expensive business. You have to render all the pixels all around. So again, long render times. And in the future, you can even expect more pixels. Also, you need a pretty damn strong graphics card to actually play it. And this is why I cannot really show you the virtual reality version on this machine. It's just not powerful enough. Also, if you have fast camera movement, you will need a higher frames per second. 30 will not cut it, so you might want to go to 50 or even 60. Then, nausea. I like that image. It's good. Anyway, avoid fast camera movements. People tend to get sick. If you're just moving around and do not have to control over the movement, you can get a little bit of nausea. Also, do not animate the rotation of the camera. In the fist I just showed you, the camera is just doing some kind of square dance. And the reason for this, if you animate the rotation of the camera, it feels like somebody's moving your head and rotate it while you want to watch over there. It's really not very nice to have some kind of movement. You'll probably have to render a high frame rate if you have fast camera movements. Again, you have to render a high resolution. And also, there are some devices out there with a very narrow field of view, and you can get pretty sick from this as well. So choose a device with a big field of view. Then we also, of course, did some multipass rendering. We rendered in Octane, but this is a Cinema 4D version. If you start rendering your animation, it's very nice to do this in different render passes, and you can just throw this to Photoshop, After Effects, or even if you're using some kind of other post-production package, like, for instance, what's his name again? Fusion. It's very nice to have different kind of layers. And what you can see here is the same scene right now in Photoshop, completely separated in those layers, which I created inside the multipass rendering. It gives a lot more freedom. And exactly the same with After Effects. So yeah, so everything comes together in 3.5 weeks. Again, we had a very nice client, a lot of people giving us advice about virtual reality and stuff. So this is the final animation. I would recommend you to watch it on YouTube on your mobile phone and see the real virtual reality experience. But with all the knowledge that I just spread to you, let's watch it one more time.
So, you have an idea for the business? Great. But now what? Take it to Spark. Spark is our innovation platform, open for all employees. Spark invites you several times per year to share your ideas in campaigns. These campaigns focus on a topic or area that matters most to the company. Submitting an idea is easy. Go to libertyglobalspark.com, find a campaign you'd like to join, write up a brief summary of your idea and add any attachments that help explain your idea. Or use the Spark app, which allows you to innovate anytime, any place, anywhere, and add relevant photos to your idea. After you've submitted your idea, the fun really begins. Everybody invited to the campaign can now see it, share it, vote, and like. Let trends and inspirations add weight to your idea and let your followers leave fruitful comments. Share your idea with others and watch it grow and develop. That's collective collaboration at its best. The ideas with the most potential are presented to experts from the management team to be evaluated. The most interesting and from then on so-called concepts will grow further with the involved departments. The best and business savvy of those concepts are implemented by the business. But the excitement doesn't end there. The best innovators are recognized and will receive prizes for their hard work. So what are you waiting for? Get your spark on.
So yeah, I think in this entire animation we used about 30 keyframes. That was it. All dynamics. Okay, well, again, really, I really like to thank you for joining me on this presentation. Also the guys on the internet. Hello, Ma. If you have any questions, I will be here at the booth. And yeah, please come to me. Thank you so much.